In Canada, we already have, in many provinces, and BC's one, laws that authorize those asset seizures. We don't have the federal grants directly for the purpose of drug enforcement. But I'll bet that Harper's working on it. Third, this is probably the most painful. Actually, it's the second most painful. Just wait till I get to the fourth. The third impact on law enforcement. Prohibition turns law enforcement and ordinary citizens into enemies. Here's Jack Cole, one of the founders of LEAP, retired New Jersey state trooper. He's describing what he did after he was assigned to narcotics as a young officer. If somebody simply passed a marijuana cigarette to me, they became a drug dealer. Every one of them went to prison for 7 years. He was talking to a college audience, so he said, "Nearly 1,000 young folks just like yourselves, just starting out in the world, just getting their education, ended up in prison for 7 years as a direct result of what I did as one undercover agent." And Jack pauses, and you hear him say rather quietly, "That's a lot of lives to destroy. It's a lot of lives to destroy." I want you to listen to what Jack is saying. Did marijuana destroy the lives of those over 1,000 young people? No. Jack is standing there saying, "I did. I did." And now James Mooney, retired Utah narcotics agent, a LEAP speaker. The interviewer asked him, "What made you change your mind about the value of drug enforcement?" Because Mooney, like many of these people, they went into it believing it was the right thing to do, that enforcement was a good thing. The interviewer asked him, "How do you change your mind?" And here's what James Mooney said. "I had a couple of people wired, making some buys inside of a home, and I could hear everything that was going on. And then I heard a little boy crying out for his mother. And knowing that I was going to take both parents away for no less than 10 years. And it just kind of struck me that, holy mackerel, I'm more of a problem than a solution. I want to remind you what Jack and James and all the others, and thousands of people who go into law enforcement, sign up for. They sign up for that motto you've all heard, to serve and protect. To serve and protect, that's what they go in for. They did not sign up for to lie and destroy. Then that's what they're asked to do. So there's three things that law enforcement ends up doing under prohibition. Gets corrupted, gets redirected to the wrong things, becomes an enemy of the citizens, and there's one more thing they do. They die. They die. And I'm going to tell Neil Franklin's story here, and here I'm not quoting exactly because I've seen him tell this story many times. One of Neil's closest friends was working an undercover job, doing a sting on a mid-level drug dealer. And this was the night when they were going to arrest that dealer. Ed Totley, Neil's friend, was going to make the final buy, and all the surveillance team was set up, and as soon as the dealer paid the money, they were going to arrest the dealer. Kind of thing happens all the time. Well, this time the dealer, who of course doesn't know that Ed is an undercover cop, decided that he'd really rather keep the drugs and the money this time. I probably don't need to tell you how they do that. If they want to keep the drugs and the money, what do they do to their customer? Not hard to figure out. Ed had given the dealer the money, was waiting for the dealer to come back with the drugs. The dealer comes back to the car, smoking a cigarette, puts out the cigarette, and shoots Ed in the head at point blank range. Sirens come on, lights flashing, because the surveillance team is there. The dealer takes off. He managed to get away briefly, but they caught him a few days later. And Neil gets called. He rushes to the hospital, but of course it's too late. There's no point. And Neil says his first reaction was, who screwed up? Who missed their assignment? Because there's supposed to be, you know, there was surveillance. The car was wired. The car had cameras. There were plainclothes people placed in various places. Who screwed up? He shouldn't be dead. Somebody should have done their job. But then in the weeks and months after that happened, Neil realized how it really works. He realized that as long as there is drug prohibition, there will be enormous profits available to anyone who decides to go into that illegal business. And as long as those profits are in that business, some of those people, some of the time, are going to decide it's in their interest to kill their competitor, supplier, or customer. And some of the time, that competitor, supplier, or customer is going to be another Ed Totley, another cop trying to do his job. And some of the time, somebody in the surveillance team is either going to be looking away at the wrong second or not quite in the right place. And another Ed Totley is going to be dead. And as long as prohibition is happening, it's going to happen again and again and again. Say something that our LEAP speakers and our law enforcement professionals will not say, but that I can say because I'm not in law enforcement. You see, our professional members don't point the finger at anyone. They take full responsibility for what they did in drug enforcement and for changing the world so the prohibition ends. They take complete responsibility for that. And they don't point the finger for who is responsible for the continued persistence of drug prohibition. But I will say who is responsible for the continuation of drug prohibition. I am. You are. We are. We are responsible because drug prohibition continues because lawmakers let it continue, and lawmakers let it continue as long as we do not use our votes to tell them it must stop. We are the ones who are responsible for the continuation of this bad policy. We are the ones responsible for that, those effects, the direct effects, the indirect effects, and what it does to all our law enforcers. And it's our duty to show with our votes and our voices that this has to end. And right now in Canada, we have a pretty unique opportunity because a couple of days ago, something happened in the House of Commons that I don't think has happened in North America before. I think this is the first time. A leader of a major party attacked a government for putting more money into prohibition and more effort into prohibition. A leader of a major party attacked the policy of prohibition. I have not seen that happen before in Canada or in the US. So this is an opportunity to show not just the liberals, but all the parties what they need to do for our support. Our votes go to people who make sensible policies, and number one in making sensible policies is getting rid prohibition. Finally, very last statement. I guarantee you, marijuana prohibition will end. I can't say when, but it is a matter not of whether it will end, it is a matter of when it will end. It will end because the discussion is coming out in public now. And when the discussion comes out in public, and when that discussion is about prohibition, not about marijuana, but about prohibition, it is inevitable that voters will find out and then governments will be forced to end this rotten policy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Steve. That was actually moving for me. Some of the things really touched me. So thank you very much for sharing that information with us today, Steve.
do want to repeat one more thing that I said at the beginning. I'm here as a stand-in for the law enforcement professionals in LEAP. You're not here to